All right, let's talk about alpha carbon halogenation of ketones and aldehydes. And so we're going to go through either an enol in acid promoted conditions, or we're going to go through an enolate in base promoted conditions. So both mechanisms, as a note here, will prefer to substitute the more substituted side of unsymmetrical ketones first. So that's a loaded sentence there. Let's talk about it, break it down a little bit more. And first, we'll simply define alpha halogenation with our simplest reaction here, just an aldehyde. So aldehydes are helpful here because they only have one alpha carbon. By definition of alpha halogenation, we would say that we'd put the halogen, either iodine, bromine, or chlorine, on that alpha carbon. And with acid conditions, so we have H3O plus here. In acid conditions, we're only going to see one equivalent of that halogen add to the alpha carbon. We'll look at the mechanism to say why, and it's because sequential halogenations are going to be slower than the first halogenation. So we'd call this compound that we just made an alpha bromo aldehyde. We'll see alpha bromo ketone and so forth. All right. So let's look at this unsymmetrical ketone. So if we take what we just said above, the alpha carbons are a little bit different on these because one side's a methyl, one side's an ethyl group on that ketone. So they're two different sides. The rule says we prefer to substitute the more substituted side first. So we get our alpha chloro ketone here, and we get one equivalent adding to that alpha carbon. And let's look at the mechanism to say why. So when we start here in our aqueous conditions, we've got a couple alpha hydrogens. I only need to invoke one of them, so that's all I'm going to do. But in acidic conditions, the first thing we always want to do is to protonate first. So we need to activate this carbonyl for our reaction. Okay, we do that, and we've got a protonated ketone. And here's where our alpha carbon comes in. So I'll just show one of these alpha protons here. And we have water as a solvent, so we're going to use that to deprotonate, and that's going to form our enol. So what we just did is essentially tautomerization from the ketone to the enol in acidic conditions. So this whole process here would be considered acidic tautomerization. All right, so that's something we can kind of pull out and use elsewhere if we ever need it, but that's exactly what we're getting to, is this enol. From there, it's just a lot like alkylation of the alpha carbon. We've got a chlorine molecule or any other halogen molecule in solution other than fluorine. We're going to tautomerize back essentially to the ketone, but in the process, instead of grabbing a proton from water or hydronium, we're actually going to grab that chlorine and form the protonated, irreversibly here, the protonated alpha chloro ketone. We then, in solution here, with our solvent, remove that proton. The ketone's more acidic than water, so that proton, that's going to favor the product here. Good reaction there to get it back to our product, full mechanism shown. Okay, so why do we only do this one time? Well, once we've added this chlorine, so the first step of the mechanism was to protonate this oxygen. Okay, well, once we've got the chlorine here, we are withdrawing electron density from oxygen to chlorine. So chlorine's getting more than its fair share of electrons. It's electronegative and it's competing with oxygen. And so once the chlorine's there, that oxygen of the ketone is less basic. So it's slower to protonate and therefore slower to undergo the chlorination reaction. So we can get through that one cycle to put the one chlorine on and then stop. Okay. If we did want to put more than one on, the basic conditions are the way to go. And so we're going to replace all alpha hydrogens on a carbon because the rate of sequential halogenations are faster than the first. We'll look at why here. So we can say two times or excess iodine, whichever we prefer, chlorine or bromine, so excess or two times, because we've got two alpha carbons on this aldehyde. And ultimately what will happen is that aldehyde gets two iodine molecules for its alpha position. All right, so how does that happen? Let's look at the mechanism here. So the first thing, we take our aldehyde, and now we're in basic conditions. So one of these two alpha protons, don't have to show both, but our hydroxide will ever so slightly, okay, so this isn't a huge equilibrium favoring the enolate, but it's enough here, so it really actually favors the reactants, but we do form an enolate. And so this is essentially tautomerization in base from the ketone to the enolate, the key intermediate here. And that enolate then acts as our alpha carbon nucleophile. However little forms, enough forms that this irreversible addition of iodine occurs. But once we're here, it turns out that this proton now, this alpha proton, is more acidic than the original, because we've got an iodine or another halogen electron withdrawing from that position. And so actually this next deprotonation is faster than the first. So once you've got one molecule of this, boom, you go straight to another enolate, which then is able to react again with another molecule of iodine faster than any other ketone or aldehyde in solution can. And so it goes all the way to the disubstituted compound faster than the original can react. So you have to go all the way to the complete substitution of an alpha carbon, okay? However, suppose we have an unsymmetrical ketone. If we add two equivalents of a halogen, we will go to the more substituted position. That's our tendency when we have those unsymmetrical ketones, and we put two bromines there faster than the methyl side will react. You get a mixture of products, but your major product is going to be the alpha dibromo ketone here. Well, take a symmetrical ketone. We can do the same thing. We can select one side over the other. Two chlorines on the left is the same with two equivalents as two chlorines on the right. So those are the same thing, only need to draw one of them because we have a symmetrical ketone. Well, suppose we do four equivalents. Well, now we go all the way to the tetrasubstituted. Okay, now we're getting all of these compounds are irritants. Okay, they blister the skin, they irritate the eyes. They're not the best compounds. Some of them used to be used in World War I for the trench warfare gases. And mustard gas reacts similarly, creates an equivalent of hydrogen chloride or HCl. These things tend to do the same thing. And so the more chlorines you add, the more dangerous you get. But these are useful synthetic intermediates in a lot of cases when you can do this. But four chlorines is possible, and you just use four equivalents, or you could say excess for this one, and you'd get all the way to the end either way. Okay, well, suppose you had a methyl ketone. So here's a little bit of a curveball here we weren't expecting. If we do three equivalents with an excess of hydroxide, we don't get the three alpha carbons with bromination. You end up with a carboxylate. And that's because you do go through that intermediate. So you can do the mechanism just like we did before with the aldehyde above and the enolates to get to this, and I'll stick with the skeletal structure, this trisubstitute, and we're using bromine, so I'll make those bromines. Chlorines would work, iodines would work, bromine's a good happy intermediate there for leaving groupability and whatnot. Well, now you've got a CBr3, and that actually is a good enough leaving group to where if hydroxide attacks the carbonyl at this point, you create a tetrahedral intermediate. I'll abbreviate the benzene ring as a phenyl group. And, you know, this isn't the greatest leaving group in the world, but it leaves enough. That's another one of those that leaves enough. We're fighting an equilibrium here. Come back here. And we kick off that carbanion. Again, not much here, but enough to where this rapid proton transfer can occur, and we lock in to the carboxylate. And we get bromoform. Okay, so CBr3, protonated there is a good solvent. Bromoform, chloroform would be HCCl3. And so we end up with a carboxylate. Not something we'd expect, but this is a good enough leaving group that if we have this fast irreversible step at the end, we can lock it into the carboxylate in the haloform reaction.